have our opening ceremonies. For the first time in my career, I will sacrifice my dignity for all of you. This doesn't move anyway, does it? No, of course, too short. All right.
That's a story.
I could tell you a story, but I think you already know the story.
What do you mean?
Ladies and gentlemen, the best laid plans of mice and men. Part of the problem, if you can call it a problem, this is what we call a double-edged sword. We were prepared. We were not prepared for this kind of turnout. I think this is what we call a damn big convention. I thank you all tremendously for your patience. What little there is left. We are hanging in here. We have had, one or two small distractions, as you may have noticed. The what? Why didn't I hear about that? Oh, that. No, we did have a gentleman who took ill earlier. It's a very, very simple, little, tiny epileptic seizure. He's going to be quite all right. He will recover fully. I don't know if I will.
Called Schuylkill Punch.
It is called Schuylkill Punch because it comes from the delightful Schuylkill River. The Schuylkill River changes color every day depending on what is being put out by the factories upstream.
I've seen green. Water, everybody, who's thirsty? Water.
Ladies first.
Thank you.
We have some very, very thirsty folks here. Fortunately, even Schuylkill Punch looks good on a day like today. I have here some.
We would prefer that everybody.
Okay, let me do my job.
Makeup!
I don't want to kiss the baby.
You know, there's an audience out there. I think they would say, hey guys. See? Oh crap.
I think we're in trouble.
We're there. Uh-oh.
What's with all those people? That's awesome. I haven't seen that many people in the studio before.
Wow.
guess that means we must be at Anthrocon Live! Oh, wow!
Okay, let's go.
Well, hi everyone, welcome to the Fun Day Puppet Show Live. We're glad to be here. How are y'all doing today?
Great. Nice to hear that.
This is the one and only Arthur Braunschweiger.
That's me, you're doing the one and only Ezra.
I am.
There he is.
Well, we're going to be here for about 3 hours tonight. We've got a lot of guest puppeteers that wanted to perform for you tonight. Hope you guys are ready for a lot of fun.
I'm going to go to the top.
Did anybody else have any trouble getting here?
Yeah.
Wow. Delays at the airport.
So we're there to, who had a delay at the airport?
Yay!
Oh, there they all are.
Who stood in line for a long time?
Yay!
That's not their fault, though. That's the fault of technology. But, no, I had a really, really bad experience. Did anybody take a cab from the airport here? Did everybody take the shuttle except me?
I think it was just you.
We paid $60 for a taxi.
Ouch.
And we went through downtown Philadelphia, about 5 different hotels.
That's awful.
I gotta tell you one thing.
What do you think?
Philadelphia is not the city of brotherly love.
I know.
As far as taxis are concerned, it's the city of sibling rivalry.
Boy.
Good grief, this guy was driving on the sidewalks. He was honking at everybody. And then he said,
what do you want?
I said, I want to get there alive.
Please help me get there alive.
Yes, indeed. Why did the music stop?
Good.
This is a bigger stage than we're used to. How many people have you watched the Puppet Show regularly?
Really?
You have no lives.
No lives.
So neither do I.
Good.
I do this thing for 4 hours every Sunday night. Good grief.
Oh, hi.
Hello.
Hello there.
1, 2, 3.
I hear you.
You know what? This is a person. I'm just gonna stand right over here.
Is it live or memorized?
It's live.
It's live. So, you must be important.
I'm a guest.
You're a guest. Be your guest.
I don't sing.
You don't sing? Bye. Actually, everyone, this is Bill.
Somebody.
Bill Holdrum.
Somebody.
Can you spell
nobody?
Oh, yeah.
Just like us! Nobody! So, how's it gonna feel to be broke like us?
You're broke?
Look at me! This is all the clothing I've got!
This is all the clothing I have!
Stand a little further than here so you can be on camera. Come stand right here. Right here! There we go! Now we can see you!
Are.
Wow, you're tall!
6'2".
Technical change out?
Click buzz.
Does this work?
Yeah, it does work. I got the last microphone.
Not really, hold it closer.
It works a little better than it was like this. Hi, everyone.
Here, let me give you one of mine. That one works better.
So,
are you a sheepdog?
Am I a sheepdog? I think so.
Please
hold on,
wait
a minute. Yeah, I'm a sheepdog.
I'm a sheepdog in my comedy troupe.
Do you really? What's his name?
It's a her.
Her name. Whoa! Is she available?
No, she's married.
Oh. Is she going to get divorced?
No, she's happily.
Happily married? Could I sway her?
I doubt it.
I could use my canine wild.
Oh.
Well, if she's taken, what are you doing tonight? I'm just kidding, folks!
Oh.
I'm just kidding. So where is the inspiration from Kevin and Kel? Where did that come from?
Kevin and Kel came because I wanted to talk about opposites. Opposites attract any kind of opposites. And the best way to do that is to deliver anthropomorphics.
Oh, kind of like Java and everyone else.
That's where Kevin and Cal came from.
Cool.
I can talk about all kinds of opposites.
I got
that. Through a rabbit and a wolf.
Rabbit and a wolf. I don't mean to bring this up, but how does that work?
They're very much in love.
And they don't eat each other.
No. Although, that's a constant theme of this trip, overcoming one's basic instincts.
How?
Well, they're well fed.
Topic number two. So, have you been into anthropomorphics for a very long time?
Just since I started Kevin and Cal. I was unaware of anthropomorphics before I started the strip, and once I started getting emails from the anthropomorphic community saying, we love your strip.
Do y'all love the strip?
The rest is history.
Y'all don't love me. They never do that for me.
I love you! Oh, good grief, no!
Freaky. My little legs can't reach up here. Can you give me a hand? Thanks, pal.
So what's your favorite thing about attending an anthropomorphic convention?
Just meeting people. Being a cartoonist, I work alone all day in my basement.
Aww.
This gets me out.
It's kind of like me, all the time, all alone in my basket. Basement, basket, all the same thing.
Have you known Dr. Conway for very long?
I met him at several cons before. Nice guy. It was a great convention. I have to say, it's running very well. He's doing a great job.
Yes, and he buys good printers.
Or not.
Wow.
No. Kagi is great. Everybody, I still love Kagi. Kagi's a wonderful guy.
So you're supposed to applaud him.
Remember at the beginning we said there were some cues you're supposed to follow?
That's one.
So how long have you been drawing comic strips?
Well, I've been drawing on the Fast Track, my first syndicated strip, since 1984.
Wow, that's a long time. Have you ever done any other kind of artwork other than comic strips?
I'm basically a cartoonist.
Cartoonist.
That's what I do, that's why I love it.
And you eat?
I love eating too.
Well, it's not too apparent.
Unlike me. Look at my gut.
I'm being fat.
Somewhere back here, we're going to have to introduce you also to one of our other cast members. Everybody knows Carrot. Yep, Carrot's back there. Hold on one second. We're going to see if we can get Carrot to make a tiny little cameo appearance, because Carrot has a question he wants to ask you.
About rabbits, I guess.
Yeah, hey, everybody, it's Carrot! Hey! Now, Carrot, come over here.
Mm-hmm.
I understand that you wanted to ask Mr. Holbrook a question here.
I do. That's all right.
Mm-hmm. So go ahead and ask him. And your response is?
As I beckon to my interpreter, could I have a translation, please?
Could you have a translation?
I don't have to look.
How to speak, Carrot.
Neither do I. I was hoping you knew. Oh, that was Carrot, everyone. Well, how are you enjoying the show?
A lot.
A lot? You're sick. Oh, my gosh. Well, we're glad to have you here. We're really glad to have you on the show. Did you possibly want to ask us a question? You can ask a question for Magic 8 Ball.
Yes. Magic 8 Ball!
Do we have him to get hold of this?
He's not here, but he's here in spirit.
Did you have a question?
No, not really.
Boy, you're an easy call-in. Call in next week. Wow. Cool. One thing I wanted to know from you, though, what's the most interesting thing you've ever drawn? In terms of like animals or people, what's the thing you're most proud of? The most interesting thing you've done?
The most interesting thing I find drawing is a dragon that I have in my On the Fast Track comic strip. It's a Lovelorn Moat Monster.
Lovelorn Moat Monster.
That was one of those!
And what do you think of Java?
Highly regarded.
Highly regarded? You can have him. Please take him with you.
Thank you!
Do you want to
he seems at home where he is.
He seems what?
He seems at home where he is.
At home where he is? Yeah, here. You don't have to take him back to Orlando.
Yeah. I'm happy here.
Does anybody want to adopt Java? Java?
I heard and I will.
I'm scared. For the first time in my life. Woo!
You don't know what he just landed on.
It was fun.
Well, everyone, this is Bill Holbrook. We want to thank you for taking the time to come to the show. Thank you.
I hope we didn't embarrass you too much.
No, we embarrass ourselves.
Well, that's true. We do that every minute.
I'm thinking hard.
But it's not because smoke's coming out of my ears.
No!
No!
No! It can only mean one thing.
No.
There's only one character I know of that sings and does things to songs like this. Me.
You got it.
disturbing. This is coming from me. My nemesis. Anthrocon has two guests of honor, and we're really fortunate to have the other one here as well. Everyone, give a big round of applause to Dan DiCarlo. You all day since I found out you were here.
Right.
Why did you name it Josie and the Pussycats and not Josie and the Puppy Dogs?
Question. We debated on it for quite a while, but then my wife insisted that we named it Josie and the Pussycats. Her name happens to be Josie.
That's a secret, folks. You've been given privileged information. And where do the names Valerie and Melody come from?
Well, those are just pulled out of the air. Valor and Melody, I just pulled out of the air. He's a dumb girl. I'm not too bright girl.
Oh, so you should have had BV.
I heard that.
And we had the third girl, was called Pepper, had glasses on. She was the environmentalist, save the world type of girl, you know, save the trees. But after a few months, a few issues, they decided to drop Pepper, and they came up with Valerie.
Really?
Yeah.
And there was also a character named Alexandra.
Yes, she was the rich girl competing for
Alan.
Alan, and also Park, and the little combo, which they never gave her.
I have another question that someone asked me earlier in the hallway. It's about the character Alan.
Yeah.
Is he really Freddy from Scooby-Doo?
It's the other way around.
It's the other way around! Ah, so Alan's the original. So they made Alan less buff and wear a white sweater and stuff and called him Freddy?
And wear the same clothes for 10 years.
Yeah, what's up with that?
You do that? Is that what you wear? The same fur coat 10 years?
I wear the same little dog tag, but not for 10 years. I'm not that old yet. There was something interesting that I read once about Josie and the Pussycats. Valerie was actually the first major African American character on the syndicated series. Is that correct?
Yes, I think that was part of the reason why they wanted her on the team. This was during the Civil Rights Movement, and they figured they needed some representation.
And there was also a follow-up series called Josie in Outer Space.
Oh yeah.
Who came up with the character Gleep?
Everybody's laughing, but I didn't hear the question.
There was a little space alien. I think his name was Bleep or Gleep or something like that. A little space alien. Don't know?
Well, we had other guys drawing it.
Oh, okay.
And writing it also.
I just wanted to know because I thought he was adorable. I thought it was cute. He was obnoxious, but he's kind of cute.
I liked him. You should have wrote in. Maybe he would have had a separate book.
Well, I couldn't write. I was only 2 years old. Would have been quite a feat.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So what do you think, since you've been here at the Anthrocon convention, what's the most memorable thing that you've seen so far?
So far. Well, I draw with a pencil and an eraser. The eraser is always in front of me. that's it. And look at the erase and you'll see what you want to change.
Very cool. That's good advice for all you upcoming artists.
Oh yeah, you need that.
And if you were going to give additional advice to any artist, what would it be?
Pick another profession.
Tell you what, boys. Don't make the puppeteering.
Yeah, please. No, what's wrong with puppeteering?
What's wrong with it?
Yeah.
Look at me. Look
put
over there.
Put the sock down and step away from this day.
Well, everyone, let's give a big round of applause to Dan, and also say hello to his lovely wife, Josie. Yeah. Now, stop by his table. He's got some wonderful artwork out there. And Dan, I was going to ask you, could I stop by tomorrow and maybe drop off a sketchbook and get a sketch? I'll pay. Okay. Thanks, everybody. This is Dan DiCarlo.
I would like to welcome you all to Anthrocon 2001, the most surprisingly large furry convention that has ever been. As I was telling a few people, the board of directors can back me up on this, as a matter of fact. I chose the Adams Mark for two reasons. One, they invited us. And two, it was a massive, monstrous, titanic, gigantic hotel. It is, or it was, on Tuesday of last week. It was huge. This place is acres and acres and acres. And I told the board, it's the perfect hotel that we can grow into. I anticipate that we will fill this hotel by 2004. I wasn't wrong, we did. I'm blushing because I'm blind. All right, quick, is that Kevin back there? Kevin, are you sure? Kevin. You see, it would have to be Kevin because he's the only kind of guy with that kind of sense of humor. I got to show you this. Kevin gave me a present last Anthrocon. He apparently thought that the lab coat that I had really didn't reflect too much of my online persona. Let's see if I can get this on. I'm going to stick this up here right now. If you didn't see it that year, you didn't miss much. Here we go. Here we are. That isn't actually the only lab coat that was gifted to me. My old lab coat, actually I sold at charity auction last year. I raised a sufficient amount of money for it to make me happy, $120, although I was devastated when a stupid pencil stick figure vixen went for $150. I thought I meant more to you people than that. Now I feel bad. However, I feel a little bit better because someone else, well, there's a story behind it. Davina of the Tiger Tribe, whom many of us know, those amazingly talented belly dancers who we see with the magnificent tiger outfits. She sent me an email one day saying, "Hi Kage, send me your lab coat." Come again? She said, "Send me your lab coat." I said, "Why?" She said, "Trust me." Everybody knows Shere Khan? The tiger says, "Trust me." He's basically saying, "Catch up or A1. But being the trusting soul that I am, and knowing that Davina's a delightful lady, I sent her my lab coat. I said, "If you do anything to it..." She said, "Oh, I won't. No. When I got that lab coat back, I went over the thing for about 6 weeks. thread by thread, wondering what the heck she did to it. It was booby-trapped somehow. And I believe it was, for the confusion, that I was most astonished at Uncle Kage's story hour, actually at the masquerade just before, the Tiger Tribe came out and presented me with a new lab coat. Wear it? Oh, what the heck? You've always wanted to see me undress, haven't you? Remind me to take the microphone out of this pocket, okay? Ben, you can edit all this out, right? Thank you. He did nod, right? I know the tie doesn't actually match. Dad, you took my black and white tie. Where's the inside of this? It really is an absolutely remarkable garment. I want to make sure I get it correct here, because she actually reproduced my lab coat literally stitch for stitch. So it is a perfect clone. How about a close-up, Benny? Now, thank you. Benny, yell if the sound levels are off. Feel free to come right up here. But get a close-up while you're at it. Even the buttons are tiger-striped. This is one classy outfit. Makes me feel furry. Furry fandom, as we know, has taken a few hits in the PR world of late. Ladies and gentlemen, do not let these bother you. These are called growing pains. Our fandom has been sequestered and private for so long that now that we're breaking into the mainstream, certainly at first people are going to react strongly to us, are they not? But bear in mind, we are where Star Trek fandom was 25 years ago and catching up fast.
I'm feeling better now.
We took a rather serious hit. Oh, here comes Benny. What did I do? Did I screw it up? When? Hang on. What?
Yeah. I'm still looking. We are recording this first.
Okay. What? Testing 1, 2. Okay, that'll work. How is it the pulpit say? Technical difficulties. Dead air? Some of us may recall that we had an article run about furry fandom in Vanity Fair magazine.
His boo.
Let us be charitable. I will beg all of you to have charity and understanding for the gentleman who wrote the article. His name was George Gurley. Can you imagine what ninth grade was like with a name like George Gurley? He suffered horribly. He was picked on. They beat him up. He deserved it, but We should show charity for him. For those of you who did not see the article, I'll briefly paraphrase. He showed up in another convention with all sorts of highfalutin promises. Oh, I'm going to do a beautiful story on furry fandom. I actually spoke to him very briefly when he asked me for an interview. He begged me for an interview, and I said, no, I do not give interviews to the media. He said, why not? And I said, because, sir, I do not believe that you are here to do any sort of thoughtful story on furry fandom. I think you're here looking for a freak show, and I'd like you to go away now. Yeah. Which he did. But then when I saw some of the folks he was talking to, I thought maybe I should talk to him anyway. Just so he gets both sides of the story. I spoke to him for an hour. It was a story hour. I sat down with the gentleman for nearly an hour, almost an hour, and told him about the wonderful aspects of our fandom, our great cultural and ethnic diversity, the highly intellectual and educated nature of our membership, the civic responsibility that we have demonstrated, the charitable works that we do, the rich history of furry fandom going back tens of thousands of years since mankind first looked upon animals and tried to meld their spirits with his and say, gee, what if they could think like we do? Let me hear you say amen! I could get used to this. Maybe I should have bought some of those robes the people in the convention before us had. I wanted to. Well, Mr. Gurley took all this down.
Mr. Gurley.
Anyway, Gurley man took this all down, and I actually had some high hopes because it's difficult to fool me. Usually, I can spot a liar very, very quickly. He caught me, I admit. Because several months later, out came the article, an entire 9 pages about people who seem to like to have intimate relations with their stuffed animals, with my name in it. Oh well. However, despite that what might be considered a serious PR hit, despite other things that have happened of recent events, we're still here. So they can try, but they ain't gonna beat us down.
Petty villain. He's somebody that's bad in the immediate area, but he's not, he doesn't affect a whole lot of people really. Now the grand villain, that's the guy that, he's the one that's out to conquer the world. He's the drug overlord, the criminal mastermind that's going to make the $1 billion score and kill 100 people doing it and doesn't care. So you've got what you might consider two different types of villains. And I've got some things that I call things to keep in mind when writing a villain. This is mostly about the grand villain. This first one...
Brock, yes. Hal probably may want to go on down each of those points and have us all comment.
That's what I point on.
Okay.
The first two work best together. This first one, I got it from someone somewhere, and I don't know where, but this first one is the villain is the hero in his own eyes. Second point goes along with this. item, don't neglect the villain's motivation. He is in the service of a cause. Best example for both of those is Hitler. You don't think Hitler really thought he was villain, do you? No, he was a hero who was leading the German people to the rightful place under the sun.
Good question in the back corner.
Yeah, what about like gravity? When gravity, like,
gravity sucks.
Gravity is generally always there, and if you get larger than the planet, you might get your own atmosphere. So,
yes.
There you go.
That too is another thing. How big, I wonder...
Is too big.
No. How big is too big? How big... I cannot remember the formula. I hated physics. I can't remember the formula. But if somebody could tell me how tall a macro would have to be before he starts to generate his own gravitational field that starts to attract people to him. Well, in theory, everybody
needs to generate a large gravitational field.
But I'm not attracted to you. Technically,
yes, you are, but you would require exceedingly sensitive instrument field.
The more question is how much lightning would it generate walking along?
Thanks, Kimo.
The question actually becomes, are they male or female? Female will obviously be attractive. More people will be more attractive.
Well, they have more mass up front.
Some more than others.
Yes, some a lot more than
others. Some a lot more than others.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he'll tell you it's not what we're looking for. And he probably doesn't even know what he's looking for. They all want to be really flawed with some stuff that you bring in. But if ask them, what do you want? They might say, think Mark Twain, think Huckleberry Finn, or do this or do that, or watch television and see what's hot. You'll have to come up with your own idea. They really don't know what they want. They want to be hit between the eyes with something really sensational. But that's rare. You usually have to work into that. And the way it becomes sensational is a lot of newspapers pick it up and you're a hot shot. It could almost dictate your terms. Almost.
Okay, Sabretooth, Bandicoot in a laundromat. Washing what? I have no idea. Okay, I'm going to give you 2 minutes. The person with the glue stick is going to have to, press the glue stick and maybe you'll hold to the back of the paper while you do it. And the person with the glitter, if you notice there's pieces of paper underneath the easels to catch stuff, is going to have to press the glitter against the glue and try to get things to work out. Anyways, start. You're gonna have to press your hand. Yeah. You're gonna have to really press the glitter against the glue. I can actually see the glue glistening off the lights. They have 1 minute remaining. Boy, this is torturous on the paper. Think of salt and pepper shakers. Okay, 45 seconds left. Seconds left. Oh my God, I actually see something forming. Next time I promise to get firmer paper. 10 seconds. They can't put it on the floor or else you can't sit. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, done. Oh, yeah. If the artist want to know, there's a bowl of water and napkins up here in case you want to wash your hands.
Integration with
Tiger. He has a sign around his neck that says, "Pump me and hear what I say." I don't know why you're all laughing. This is a sound pump. Apparently it talks to you when you try to pump the liquid soap out of him. Just take it around. What? I don't know, it just says pump me and hear what I say. You have to buy it to find out what he says. Let's start the bidding at $20. $20 for the mysterious pumping tiger. I have $20. $50. We want to know what he says. I have $50. $50 for the sound pump, audio tiger soap pump. Pump me and hear what I say. $50. I have $50 for the audio tiger soap pump. $50 donated, by the way, by Killjoy. $50 going once. Don't the rest of you want to know what he says when you're pumping? $50 going once. $50 going twice. Sold for $50. Excuse me.
Nope, $300 then. $300. Is there any more than $300?
Rigel.
Yes.
I will make an addition to the item. If it goes over $400, next run I do, which will be before further confusion, I will do a set of colors to their request. They name the colors, I will print them.
How about $500?
$500 for the set and a custom design. $500. Is anyone going to go over $500? Currently the bid is $500. $500 going once. $500 going twice. Sold for $500.
Wow. This is called the Totally Retro Collection. It is an actual compact luggable with oh-so-classic software to go with. What do we have? Lotus 1-2-3, 5 1/4-inch drives, and DOS. This is a museum piece.
Is it functional?
What do I bid for a piece of computing history that the Smithsonian would love to have? $1. What? I have $1. Five.
Ten.
Oh, lots of people. 20.
25.
Is it functional?
Is it functional? It doesn't say. Of course, when they were new, they weren't functional. Look at all these 5 1/4-inch discs you get. You can amaze your friends. I am at $25, I believe, am I not?
Okay, once again, we have to do this next act in order to fulfill some requirements. The Federal Broadcasting Commission says that whenever we do a show like this, we have to dedicate at least 3 minutes of the program to educational material. Hey, I don't make up the rules, I just have to follow them, okay? But, here's our little educational bit. I think once they start the music, you'll recognize it. So, I just got out of the way. A little something for your education.
As your body grows bigger,
your mind grows stronger, your strength to learn, knowledge is power.
Your schoolhouse rocking, a chip on the block of your favorite schoolhouse, the mountain.
Thank you.
Won't get bigger. He'll be 4 years old in September.
Gosh.
He's doing very good.
Yes, he is.
He's a show animal.
He's soft too.
Wow, he's really
soft. Now their ears
soft.
Are that large for hearing, but.
Hello.
You'll have to be another
pet.
First of all, for the Anthrocon Board of Directors for 2000. Yes, yes. Now, those of us who were in the music seminar up here decided to write a little something for the guy in the white lab coat over there. Uncle Kage, if you don't start clapping, he may not come up here. Give him a big hand. Thank you.
That's my line.
That was rather unexpected. I thank you. What are we doing here again? Right, yes. End of the... Already? We have been having so much fun, haven't we? This is the closing ceremonies. This is the final hour of Anthrocon 2001. The... Oh, all the stairs going, oh, God, thank you. I'm going to introduce some of the folk who are up on stage right now. At my right, that's Susan Parkin over there. You who handled programming for us this year, all that fine programming with your assistance she put on. We have Peppermint here in the Vash the Stampede costume, thank you. She was the driving force behind the con book, that magnificent con book, such a pristine con book, except for the blah, blah, blah part. To my right, I have Jonas F.R., who is Points, who is the real brains behind Anthrocon. Left, we all know Rigel, the guru of both the masquerade, the charity auction, and the one dance that one night. Who here does not know Tiger Wolf, our internet man. The cool tiger there, Benny Philip Pollard, in his lovely sunglasses, who has been doing the videography and who is going to make the absolutely unprecedentedly wonderful Anthrocon 2001 highlight video, which should be available in August. Soon. How's that? Soon. All the way on the left. Peter Capesser with two P's, two S's, don't forget. He is the man of the art show. There can be no other way to describe how the art show works because he makes it. Dr. Samuel Conway, but I am better known to you all as Kagemushi. Or Uncle Kage. It was a wonderful bit of applause, but once again, I have...
And if you were going to give additional advice to any artist, what would it be?
Pick another profession.